na biktima po namin ay may humihingi po talaga kami ng kapatawaran. Sorry po talaga sa nagawa namin. Ayaw na ako may dalalang kusurban ng kapusukan. Kaya ako nagawa. So, hindi po talaga namin yung intention ng o hindi po talaga yung purpose namin na mangyari na gano'n.
Hindi ng tawad ng ano. Sana magpatawad na kami.
Let us start by talking about the landmark case of People v. Andan. On February 19, 1994, Marian Guevara, the victim, was walking along a subdivision in Baliwag, Bulacan, when Pablito Andan, the accused, invited her inside his house. He used the pretext that the blood pressure of his wife's grandmother should be taken. The victim agreed to take her blood pressure as the old woman was her distant relative. She did not know that nobody was inside the house. Accused then punched her in the abdomen, brought her to the kitchen, and raped her. Thereafter, he dragged the unconscious victim to an old toilet at the back of the house and left her there until dark. When night came, the accused pulled Marian, who was still unconscious, to their backyard in order to transfer her to the vacant lot. When the victim moved, he hit her head with a piece of concrete block. He heard her moan and hit her again on the face. After silence reigned, he dragged her body towards a shallow portion of the lot and abandoned it. The trial court based its decision convicting the accused on the testimonies of the three policemen, the mayor of Baliwag, Bulacan, and four news reporters to whom the accused gave his extrajudicial oral confessions. It was also based on photographs and video footages of accused's confessions and reenactments of the commission of the crime. On appeal, there were three issues raised by the accused, but for purposes of this discussion, we will only deal with one. The issue is whether or not the trial court erred in using as basis of its judgment of conviction the testimonies of the police investigators, reporters, and the mayor on the alleged confession of the accused during the custodial investigation as it was allegedly made without the assistance of counsel. The Supreme Court, in its decision, offered to make a distinction. Number one, the Supreme Court emphasized that when the police arrested the accused, they were no longer engaged in a general inquiry about the death of Marian. In fact, they already considered the accused a prime suspect even before they arrested him. Accused was already under custodial investigation when he confessed to the police. Considering that the police failed to inform the accused of his constitutional rights when he was investigated and interrogated, his confession is therefore inadmissible in evidence. Ang nangyari kasi dito was, pinick-up nila yung accused without warrant, no? And then they brought him to the police station, interrogated him, and made him admit to the commission of the crime. And at this instance, the Supreme Court ruled that the admission or the confession allegedly made by the accused before the police officers was inadmissible in evidence because it violated Section 12, Article 3 of the Constitution. It violated, in particular, his Miranda rights, his right to remain silent, and his right to have competent and independent counsel of his choice. However, on the following day, the accused was still in detention when the mayor visited the accused at the police station where he was detained. The accused requested for a private talk with the mayor. They then went inside a room and there the accused confessed that he committed the crime. Here, the accused's oral confession before the mayor is admissible. What happened here was when the mayor took the witness stand, he testified that it was the accused himself who requested for a private audience with him, and it was during his meeting with the accused that the accused allegedly confessed to him the commission of the crime. And the mayor even pointed out that even before the accused could continue his confession, he opened the door of the room and requested the media to witness the accused's alleged confession. That was what the mayor testified, and that was the reason why the Supreme Court ruled that his oral confession before the mayor was admissible in evidence against him. Furthermore, his confession was not made in response to any interrogation by the mayor. In fact, the mayor did not question the accused at all. No police authority ordered the accused to talk to the mayor. It was accused himself who spontaneously, freely, and voluntarily sought the mayor for a private meeting. The mayor did not know that accused was going to confess his guilt to him. When accused talked with the mayor as a confidant and not as a law enforcement officer, his uncounseled confession to him did not violate his constitutional rights. The rules on custodial investigation do not apply to a spontaneous statement, not elicited through questioning by the authorities, but given in an ordinary manner whereby a person orally admits having committed a crime. What the Constitution bars is the compulsory disclosure of incriminating facts or confessions. The rights under Section 12 are guaranteed to preclude the slightest use of coercion by the state as would lead the accused to admit something false, not to prevent him from freely and voluntarily telling the truth. And number three, accused's confessions to the media are likewise admissible in evidence. The confessions were made in response to questions by four news reporters, not by the police or any other investigating officer. Statements spontaneously made by a suspect to news reporters on a televised interview are deemed voluntary and are admissible in evidence. The interview was recorded on video that showed that the accused confessed to the crime willingly, openly, and publicly. Confessions to the news reporters were given free from any undue influence from the police authorities. The news reporters acted as news reporters when they interviewed the accused. They were not acting under the direction and control of the police. They were there to check accused's confession to the mayor. They did not force the accused to grant them an interview. In fact, they asked his permission before interviewing him. They interviewed him on separate days, and not once did the accused protest his innocence. Instead, he repeatedly confessed his guilt to them. He even supplied all the details in the commission of the crime and consented to its reenactment. The accused's verbal confessions to the newsmen are therefore not covered by Section 12, Paragraph 1 and Paragraph 3 of Article 3 of the Constitution. Take note of this. The Bill of Rights does not concern itself with the relation between a private individual and another individual. The Bill of Rights governs the relationship between the individual and the state. The prohibitions therein are primarily addressed to the state and its agents. What does this mean? The Miranda rights under Section 12, Article 3. And what are those Miranda rights? The right to remain silent, the right to have competent and independent counsel, preferably of his own choice, and the right to be informed of said rights. They are applicable only against the police authorities trying to elicit an admission or confession from a suspect in a custodial investigation or in an atmosphere akin to a custodial investigation. But this does not mean, however, that a private individual can just force another to confess to a crime. A forced confession will always be inadmissible in evidence. And take note of Article 32 of the Civil Code. any person, whether a public officer or a private individual, who forces another to confess to a crime against his will or under duress or under threat or intimidation will be liable for damages. That is explicitly stated in the said article of the Civil Code. The decision in People versus Andan was reiterated in several later decisions. In People versus Dumantay, the Supreme Court emphasized that the fact that the extrajudicial confession was made by the accused while inside a detention cell does not by itself render such confession inadmissible. The accused in that case claimed that the atmosphere in the jail when he was interviewed was tense and intimidating and was similar to that which prevails in a custodial investigation. But the Supreme Court was not persuaded by the argument of the accused. According to the Supreme Court, the interviewer stayed outside the cell and the only person besides the interviewer was the uncle of the victim. The accused at that time could have refused to be interviewed, but instead he agreed. He answered questions freely and spontaneously, and according to the radio reporter, the accused said he was willing to accept the consequences of his act. There was also no evidence to show that the reporter was a police beat reporter, and even assuming that he was, it has not been shown that in conducting the interview in question, his purpose was to elicit incriminating information from the accused. To the contrary, and the Supreme Court took judicial notice of this fact, media are known to take an opposite stance against the government by exposing official wrongdoings. Another case is People versus Quitola. Here, the presence of the police officers did not exert any undue pressure or influence on the accused, coercing him into giving his confession. The interview was not in the nature of a custodial investigation as the response of the accused was made in answer to questions asked by the reporter and not by the police. There is also no showing that the field reporter colluded with the police authorities to elicit inculpatory evidence against the accused. Neither is there anything on record which suggests that the reporter was instructed by the police to extract information from him. Moreover, accused could have refused to be interviewed, but instead he agreed. A review of the taped interview would show that he answered questions freely and spontaneously. In the old case of U.S. versus Santos, a 1913 case, the Supreme Court had already emphasized that if a confession be free and voluntary, the deliberate act of the accused with a full comprehension of its significance, there is no impediment to its admission as evidence, and it then becomes evidence of a high order. Since it is supported by the presumption, a very strong one, that no person of normal mind will deliberately and knowingly confess himself to be the perpetrator of a crime, especially if it be a serious crime, unless prompted by truth and conscience. And lastly, in People versus Soria, the Supreme Court rejected accused's contention that her admission to a news reporter is admissible in evidence. In that case, the accused maintained that her admission was given under intimidating and coercive circumstances, since the same was made when she was already detained at the police station. The accused, however, in that case, not only agreed to be interviewed, she also provided details on why and how she perpetrated the offense. Accused's confession to the news reporter, therefore, was given free from any undue influence from the police authorities.